And pretty good timing as well, because all the action is going down. Percy with three frags in a row, all headshots. And C-Play already in a position to pick up this round. And there we go, Percy with a fourth as well. And although Zanzia did drop a 37 for 10 in that first map and pretty much overshadowed everybody else in the server, it's important to mention that Percy got over 20 kills himself. And he was still a pretty big cog in the C-Play wheel. So it's easy to get carried away with Zanzia, who did, to be fair, perform just ridiculously. But Percy was solid as well. And this is a map that is very, very different to Cobblestone in a bunch of different ways. AWP is nowhere near as crucial as in Cobblestone. In actual fact, a lot of teams will not even bother running with an AWP on either side, especially not on T side. So I do wonder if Zanzia is going to run with the AWP, and if he is, if he's going to have the same impact that we saw on Cobblestone. Regardless though, as I'm talking, Force Buy up from LDLC, they've picked up the first frag onto Barry. And in this best of three, LDLC have to win this map to take us into cash map decider. So C-Play are in a good position already on the CT side, on the easier side, with a round to the good, but they've just lost their second player. Make that a third as well with the Tech 9. Toy New just ripping through. And now that is going to leave A very exposed, and it will be planted. Holst has a decision to make. Do you want a 1v3 and try and clutch this round, or do you just want to save that for mass? It appears that he's still caught in two minds. And he's going to pick himself up a Tech 9. He's looking for some kills. Matt Hend is low on HP. Going in again is Holst. Gets the kill, looking for exit frags, and he has made this a little bit more painful for LDLC, but they'll still be very happy with this result. Force Buy, a hope and a prayer with Tech 9s. And it ended up that Lord Gaben was there to give them that round in the end. Holst does keep the FAMAS and a Tech 9, which isn't too shabby from his perspective, but C-Play, that is the first hurdle that they've failed to jump over. And LDLC will be looking for more here. They'll be looking for blood. Wish the cast would do a giveaway to appease everyone who bet on LDLC. That's not quite how it works, buddy. But, I mean, you're talking like LDLC have already lost this game. There's still another map or two to play, potentially. This game's not over just yet, guys. So, Mr. David, is that? Keep yourself optimistic. You never know. Maybe LDC are going to surprise you and pick up this map. Nova on Muff, who is taking that onto A. I would have thought if you're going to take a Nova, realistically, you'd want to go Apps or maybe even on B, but he's running it in mid and had a peek there with his pistol. Which is interesting to say the least, because that is probably the last place I'd expect to see a Nova played. Now pulling it back onto the site itself. And maybe we're going to have another upset round here with C-Play locking down on CT side. Here comes the push in. There's an overhead shot that will just detach limbs and decapitate players. The Muff's picked up three kills, nearly a fourth, but Zanzi is there to connect the dots. And Devil now must be scratching his head, wondering, guys, what just happened? A Nova just ripped us to shreds. He's got the bomb, 24 seconds, he's rushing for this site, and actually this is the correct play. There's just the one player in the form of Holst on this site, but Devil's going to check every single corner, and as long as Holst just peeks out at the right time, it will be a kill, and he stops the bomb from being planted. So Devil, there's a couple glimpses there, but Jesus, that Nova work was fantastic. Yo, Kier, I mean, the map's not over until 16 rounds, buddy. I mean, comebacks happen all the time in this game. It's one of the reasons Counter-Strike is such a fantastic game to watch in Shoutcast, because you never quite know what's going to happen. LDLC definitely did look weak on Cobblestone, there's no denying that. I'm not going to even for a second defend their performance there, because it was pretty shabby. But then again, C-Play performed fantastically. I think a lot of people are getting on LDLC's back. Give credit where it's due. So you played very, very well indeed. And we get the two rounds in a row where the team that probably shouldn't have won did win. And now here comes a potential third as the terrorists are just barreling into the site and pick up three kills. That headshot from Body looked like it was round the corner there onto Zanzit. Maybe his ego's too big after that last map. And he just dinked him. but Fox with 6 HP needs to play this one super careful. He's back in pit. That's the most passive place that he could ask for right now. And look at this movement. That is fantastic. Jumping up and Devil gets the 1D. So 3 rounds in a row, we've had the team on a force buy. We had very, very little behind them. Pick up the round and force the opposition onto an eco. And I casted another game like this the other day, and I can't for the life of me remember who it was. But we had, I think it was LGB versus someone. We had like 7 or 8 rounds in a row where teams would just trade rounds. And so neither team bought up enough for an economy. And we just kept having that all the time. It made for really entertaining Counter-Strike. Fantastically entertaining Counter-Strike. But this time, see, play tap first. They say, no, we're going to eco this time. We want to give ourselves the best chance of winning more rounds in the long run rather than just focusing for the next one. Toy's got the first kill of this one, but there's Zanzia once again with that P2K doing work. The trade-off is still in LDLC's favour. Zanzia and Muff, two remaining Danes. Muff's been caught and he's been dropped. Zanzia, they knew the last time he was spotted was in Garden, where he got the P2000 kill on Matt Hen, so they know he's around this vicinity. And they do get the headshot anyway, so LDLC do pick up the third round, but again, that was an eco from C-Play. And are they going to throw all their eggs in the basket this time? Yes, they are. That's very true, Kia. I can understand that. It's annoying because you know how good they can play. Yes. There are a lot of frustrating teams in Counter-Strike that, on their day, are world beaters. But when they play bad, they're really, really poor. So I can understand, for sure. I get the frustrations. I don't have any favorite teams, but I want to see good Counter-Strike. So when I see a team making mistakes and doing dumb things, it does annoy me, to be honest with you. So I totally understand where you're coming from. Molly and Smoke both thrown down onto Arches. Molly very nearly got extinguished by the smoke. He's just a couple of millimeters away. Muff is the first person to take damage. He's under 29 HP, so he's not feeling too healthy at this point. Not a lot of grenades to play with for the CTs, but they have Smoke Banana once more. Which could keep the T's back for a few more moments. That's Percy with a nice shot there. And breaks the deadlock with about a minute to go in the round. 53 seconds now, and the terrorists are barreling into the A site. This time, that is the exploited site. And it has been exposed. Zanzia getting sprayed down through the smoke, and CT's trying to come in and get the retaken effect. Devil's in a great position here. I don't know if anyone's guessed it. They haven't. They jump in. And Devil with no bullets has to reload, but he doesn't get forced down. There we go. Finally, they get the kill onto him, but the CTs haven't really made any room here. They've got frags, but they haven't got real estate. And that bomb is still ticking down. Neither of these players have a defuse kit. They're still losing players left, right, and center. Barry is going to be going in for the final kill, realizing there's not enough time. He's going to save the AK-47 to give him a fighting chance through in the 7th round instead. The name of the streamer, there's two of us, buddy. I'm the caster, my name's Metis, and our producer is the lovely Ruben. And we're bringing you this best of three. Also, guys, I would highly recommend, because we have a lot more action lined up here on Hitbox for the CS Arena. If you are enjoying the commentary and you're enjoying the games and the teams, hit the follow button. Completely free, it'll only take you a couple seconds to do, and it will notify you every time we go live here. So, definitely give that follow button a smash. And we will see you in future best of threes. But let's keep it back on board with this one. It is an eco round, which is why I kind of went off topic for a few moments there. LDLC have already nearly equaled the amount of rounds they got on Cobblestone, which is pretty crazy to think of it that way. They've got 6 rounds on Cobblestone. They've already got 4, and it's shaping up to be a 5th. So CTs, they're trying to keep these weapons. That flashbang was perfect. It forces Muff out. You can see now that Fox, through the apps, just narrowly misses out on his opportunity, but Muffet moves once again and he gets punished. P250s are plenty for the Danes, and they're starting to rotate round. It's Percy taking point, coming through library. Bombs being planted from Matt Hend. And, well, can they even get a kill from this point? Because that's what they're going to be hoping for. Run through, conga lining through the smoke. Here comes the final one, Zanzir, who decides to break the mold, break the chain. He's looking for entries. There we go. Actually, it turns out to be an exit frag more than an entry. And he does nab off with an EM4 to give them a better round of it going through. And that may end up being him able to afford an AWP in the next round if he can save this one. There's a frag there, looking for a second one, comes through. Speedway, and Body takes him down. So, made that as expensive as possible. Are we going to see a Glass Cannon AWP from Zanzi? He's got enough money to do it, and he's gone for it. And it's not even Glass Cannon, he just hasn't gone for head armor, which isn't that important against AK-47s. And an AWP anyway. So we finally see what Zanzir can bring to the table on the CT side with an AWP in his hands. He's gone mid, very quickly got there, realizing he didn't have the best spawns. There's no point challenging mid on T steps because he's already in position. The chances of you being successful are that much less. But now the flashbang has come through mid. That's forced off Zanzir. He's had to relocate back onto the site. But again, it's the entry frags in favor of the terrorists. His body through apps, make short work of Percy. Zanzi with the AWP's about to get flashbang to the face, quickly turns his back. There is the smoke and another flash as well. The terrorists are doing such a good job of fending off the CTs and making every single second count. And whereas C-Play, again, may be thinking about even saving here, the problem is that they're already going to be up against it on this half. This is going to be six rounds to the terrorists. They'll be happy with this starting off. And already got six rounds. Zanzi is going to save the AWP. And LDLC have already equalized what they got on Cobblestone, which was six rounds overall on both halves. LDLC have came out to play on Inferno. And for those of you wondering, I did actually speak to my producer about this at the break, about Zanzir, and I was saying, you know, if Zanzir can perform as well as he did in that first map, this may be over really quickly and C-Play could potentially 2-0. But then there's this important thing to take into consideration. Inferno's a very, very different map for AWPers. Cobblestone, AWPers can compete mid, they can go onto B, there's lots of long range for you to utilize the AWP to its strongest effect. Whereas Inferno, really, there's only two places where you're going to have AWPers, maybe three at a push. That's through mid, that's up banana, and potentially now and again you might see an AWPer go into apartments and try and cause a bit of mayhem. But that's more of a gimmicky play. So Zanzi can't have anywhere near as much impact as he did in Cobblestone. You can see that reflected already. As I'm speaking, the terrorists are pushing through. Barry gets the spray down with the FAMAS, but lots of information has been accrued as a result. Perry up there, Percy I should say, up there in apps gets himself too. And this is one of the first times that we've seen the C-Play going blow for blow with the terrorists on this A push. But it has been brought back to a 2-on-2 familiar territory for C-Play. They haven't won a single one of these 2v2 confrontations thus far on Inferno. And it is Fox and Body up against Zanzit and Holst, the first of which is Zanzit with the AWP, gets the kill. But there was nowhere near enough teamwork between the two CTs. They do just about escape by the skin of their teeth. But the fact that Zanzir went peeking while Holst was throwing his smoke was a lack of communication. And it nearly costed them so huge. What you want there is for if Zanzir gets sprayed down, that Holst is instantly there to retaliate and reply. In 2v1s, you have to use the man advantage. Otherwise, you face potentially losing the round. But C-Play win the round. I think I saw Percy. Yeah, he got the AWP just before the round ended. So he can just jump and quickly throw that across to Zanzir. Bront, I'm not entirely sure which corner you're talking about, buddy. I'm sorry. I may not have been watching the same camera perspective as the producer, because he's controlling the camera and he's controlling the stream. If you explain, then I'll try and put your mind at ease. You see the terrorists coming through, but they've walked into a snowstorm with the flashbangs landing on top of them, and this is just a massacre from the CTs without losing a single player. Only Barry losing hit points. It's all on Fox. And he is going to be wincing after that devastation that he just witnessed on B. The bomb's been dropped as well in a really horrible place. So Fox, I mean, best case scenario here is that he goes and does a bit of economic damage. He just got tagged from Zanzi around the corner as well. He did, in fairness, walk into that one somewhat. He's on top of sandbags and, well, that's going to be a rip in pepperonis. C-Play pick up the round. This could be a potential eco in effect as well from LDLC. They do have enough money to buy up, but it's not going to be a fantastic buy on a couple of their players. There you go, P250 in the hands of Devil. What does Toy have? Okay, he's been dropped an AK. So it's better than I thought it would be. It's still not fantastically good, but it's definitely possible for them to claw this round back. Nice shot from Zanzir. right off the bat from Banana Cart. This is part of the tournament, absolutely. There is another 2 days of matches, guys. I think the schedule is below the stream. You can see the times and everything like that. I'm just speaking Zplay. I mean, again, they just go back to basics and smash LDLC. I was trying to call out a strat, but LDLC just came through the woodwork, walked into crosshairs, and just got smashed. This is part of the tournament. Yeah, if you look below the stream, this is why I'm saying follow the stream, guys, because we are going to have 2 more days of full of casting, full to the brim of casting with these teams. So you'll see the schedule right below the stream. Last round, I'm just going to talk about this because it's an eco round here, guys. You're expecting Zplay to win this for you, and I like to interact with you guys. Copley did a 3-1 without even checking up his stairs. He just went in. I had no issues clutching it. I think sound played a pretty huge part of that, and just raw game sense as well, Bron. He had a general idea of where the team was, and it's kind of a 50-50, right? In situations like that, you have to have your gut instinct and you have to have the conviction to follow it through. If he feels, because if you have to remember as well, the bomb was dropped outside of the doors in that 1v3. So the chances are the CTs would try and camp on top of the bomb rather than going the long way around and potentially losing the bomb to a bomb plant, if that makes sense. So I think he made a gut instinct reaction call and just went full in and had the conviction to follow it through. I don't think there's anything dodgy about the way Zanzia played that last map. I think he's completely legit and clean. He just had a great map. Hopefully that helps. Anyway, we now have a buy-up round. It's back to 6-6. This was looking like it could slip away pretty easily from Zplay. But credit to them. They've dug on. It's still going to be a good half for LDLC if they can keep it 6 rounds. But of course, you better believe they're hungry for more. Exchange of frags. Nice one from Fox again. Apsis seem to have been the Achilles heel of Zplay so far on their CT side. But again, the retake is too strong from Berry. And I say retake, the bomb's not even been planted yet. Matt Hend wanted to get that bomb down, but when 2 players died, he couldn't go for the bomb plant, is what I was trying to say. Because it would have been way too dangerous, and Holsters take that kill and 76. Looking a bit sketchy for LDLC now on their T side. It was looking so good at one point, but I feel like Zplay have started to understand the attack patterns of LDLC and some of the mistakes they were making by peeking needlessly and not holding apps enough. They're starting to like paint over some of those cracks. So I think Zplay will probably get 9 rounds here on CT side. That's my gut feeling. Here comes a spray down. It's a forced buy up from LDLC. But again, look at how easily they push onto the A site. There is a player up in apps, which is Muff, and he does get 1 kill, but that bomb's still been planted. It's 2 Tech 9s, he's not expecting them to win from this position, but we've seen crazy things happen in Counter-Strike, of course. Flashbangs coming through from the CTs, trying to breach their way in with minimal casualties. Molly landing in pit, that's going to force out the pit player, or maybe not, because Body's just going to go ahead and get himself a frag. There's Matt Hend as well, but he gets Molly down, and he drops down from the box. Oh dear, that's like the 3rd or 4th Molly kill we've seen in this best of 3 thus far. Yeah, no worries, Bront, no worries. What, the bomb's gonna explode? No, it's not. What the hell happened there? I think my GoTV just lagged. I could hear the beeping and like the bar stopped moving. I thought, Jesus Christ, has he let go of it? No, he just about defused the bomb. GoTV, oh my god, you just scared me. Okay, LDLC with 6 rounds, now have a force buy, and a full buy as well on top of that. It is the last round of the half. Not a fantastic selection of grenades, it's a bit bare on a couple of players, but they do have enough to make this work. And they've been forcing on A so many times that they've drew out a lot of CT players, and in doing so they're able to push into B, but that was 2 entry frags onto B, by the way. This time I think there were 3 players from the CT on B. They weren't expecting Muff in the corner. That Molotov's going to do serious damage, and it does end up picking up the kill. That's what, 6th Molly kill that we've seen thus far. And Zanzia in a 1v2. If this was the Zanzia from Cobblestone, you bet your house, you bet your life savings on him picking this one up for himself. Not been quite the mastermind on Inferno. Finds himself on 9-6. That Molotov, though, forces Matt Hend out of position. And that's just raw game sense again. You're assuming someone's going to be in that position in a 1v2 because you can get crossfire set up on this site. Hello. That was a bit odd, not gonna lie. But he didn't check the other spot, and he goes down. He may have seen the barrel just sticking out the corner there. And it's gonna be 8-7. So, I thought, you know, Cplay probably would have edged towards 9-6 once the comeback was on its tracks, but still, LDLC get a very good T-half. All things considered, it would be easy to get dismayed from their perspective, because at one point it was 6-2, I believe. But still, it's a very, very good half from LDLC, who now find themselves on the CT side of things. Yeah, big random. I think he saw his shoulder or, like, the gun sticking out or something. I think you are right. We have a pause coming in, guys, so let me know. What do you guys reckon? Do you think Cplay can bring this back and potentially take the second map and finish this game straight up a 2-0? Do you think LDLC on their own map are going to bring things back and take it into a third map? I'd be interested to see what you guys have to say. 16-13, that's who for? Catch you later, Bronst. Or Bront, sorry. Match will be live in a few minutes, guys. So, I'm just going to sit here and fill in some time. If I'm a bit quiet, it's because I'm taking drinks. I've been solo casting for the last few hours, so I'm trying to make sure my voice doesn't die. So, I hope you understand, guys. So, I'll be back in just a couple. I'll keep an eye on chat as well. 16-13 Cplay, okay? I predict overtime. I'd love to see that. I would love to see that, Zalo. Or Zalo, sorry. Zalo, that's it. My second is really small, so I struggle with like L's and I's to see if it's an L or an I, basically. Sixteen-14 to Cplay, Kevin Chan. I agree, I think it's gonna... I'm not necessarily on the 16-14, but I think it's gonna go right down to the last few rounds here. I don't think we're going to see one team just steamroll. You would like to see it go to cash. 2-1 LDLC. I mean, LDLC are a solid team on cash. For sure. So I can definitely see that if Cplay let this map slip, not only psychologically speaking are they going to be at a disadvantage, but I think I would also fancy LDLC to take cash. I think that's a fair shout. Caster's name, I'm Metis, and my producer is Ruben. The guy that you can't hear, but he's the unsung hero, the guy in the background doing all the streaming and all that good stuff. So, we are live onto the second half here, guys, in the pistol round. Roles reversed. LDLC now on CT side, and Cplay on the terrorist side of things, who will desperately want in this round to put themselves an even higher round buffer. Look at Devil, he could be a huge player in this round. Up on the balcony, I like this because it puts him further than head height, which is a position I'm expecting. The crossfire down somehow, Zanzia manages to survive and get back into apps. That is ridiculous. He should have been a dead man. He finally goes down because he has to repeat to help the rest of his team. But Zanzia, what is he wearing? I realize it's Kevlar, but geez, the Iron Man. So LDLC do end up winning that pistol round very comfortably in the end. And Cplay are going to retaliate with Tech 9 and Armor to try and rush in with this one. And, well, I say rush in, but they're playing this one slow. Very slow and steady wins the race, it would appear, is Cplay's motto. Hoping for a couple pushes from CT side. It's something that a lot of CT sides will do to try and get information. Because with Tech 9s and armor, the issue is that if you just all rush into a site, there's strength in numbers, and that gun's so brutal. But you can see up on the map, there's two players pushed down aggressively through Banana from CTs, and that's going to be Body and Matt Hend, who are just sat there. getting a lot of information, so the rest of the CDs simply don't have to push. They don't have to get information because they know that no rush is imminent on to B. And if it is, in Banana, a close-range claustrophobic environment like that, SMGs win pretty much every day of the week. However, their smoke has dissipated, and they will be pushing back. The T's have still yet to make a move. Here we go, through Banana, and it's going to be the aforementioned Matt Hend and Body who are going to be at play here. Still three players on CT. Here comes the third, Toy News, through Speedway. The question is, can the T's breach this defense before he gets close enough? And the answer seems to be a resounding no. It's gone for a 2-on-2 trade, but here is Toy New now, through the smoke, gets the kill, and Percy and Zanzier have it all to do. They're going to get the bomb planted, which is the first tick in that box, but they both fall instantly afterwards. And I can't even say that's like a really good round for them. It would have been if it was a full-on eco, but they force-bought that one. They committed to that round. And just to add salt on the wounds, all the CTs are going to be able to pick themselves up Tech-9s to go through with. But because they do get the bomb plant, they're able to buy up again, realizing that there's a small chance that all of LDLC would have bought up. And I really like this play from Cplay as well, you know. It makes a lot of sense to me. You've just won a force buy round. You're thinking, okay, it's going to be probably a Glock train or maybe some Tech 9s with armor. Let's keep SMGs in play. They have three SMGs. So if you can get some kills here with the Galils, you can definitely make this round work for you. And look at the CTs pushing down aggressively. To me, that suggests they assume this is a flat-out eco. They are not respecting the possibility that Galils are on the side. There's Gorillas in the mist. And Cplay, like quilled vipers, ready to strike. Muff is doing such a good job of running interference here, but they've let the jig up. They've let the game go. As Zanzia sprays through that smoke with a Galil, you can see the CTs instantly go, oh crap, we nearly fell into a Venus flytrap, face first. Let's just back away and wait for them to come to us. 45 seconds remain on that timer. And there is action going down on B. Holst gets the first kill. Need to be so careful of Body. The MP9 at close range really can rip through you. And they get the entry. They force out Toyny, who's now rotating through CT. This is genius calls. The problem is that they've lost this confrontation early on the site. It's a 1-for-1 trade. Fox has been dropped. They need to be careful for the player that's tight on the left-hand side. That is going to be Devil. And he gets one kill and a second kill as well. And it could potentially be a third kill. And he's going to get that one. MP9 godlike mode enabled. And Holst with 10 seconds has to push in. There's the first. He's going to have to go for this bomb plant, and he's going to get it. There could still be life in this round, a round that I thought was dead and buried. Toy News giving his position away. The flashbang out from Holst. Can he pull off the clutch, the four-man, and the ninth round? No, he can't. Toy News with the FAMAS, too strong. And LDLC get their 10th round. Oh boy, what a strange round that was, full of twists and turns and storylines, but it's LDLC, the Frenchman, and the Belgian on their team that get the clutch and get the two-round lead, and that would have been a huge round for Cplay as well. They would have been able to buy up all those lost weapons. Instead, they may be finding themselves in eco-territory or force-buy territory. Yo, Lefty, what's up? Thanks, man. Glad you're enjoying it. I'm back to a pause. I'm not sure if this is technical related. I assume it is because the fifth LDLC player has dropped from the server. So, I'm just going to try and fill in the time again. My heart rate is off the chart. Another reason why I don't bet is because I don't think my heart could take it. If I was betting on a team and it was a game this close, my heart would just explode. So I'm going to bring up the scoreboard and just let you guys know who's performing and who maybe not so much. And really, it's very, very even across the board. Nobody is particularly standing out as like a top-tier player right now, and nobody is underperforming. Everyone's around the same scoreline. You can see on LDLC the difference between top and bottom frag is only 2. And on Cplay, very much the same. Just 6 separates top from bottom. Barry's on 10 for 12, and Muff and Percy are both on 16 frags. So incredibly close across the board, and you can see that reflected in the overall scoreline as well of 10 to 8. So we have the fifth player back on the server, and now LDLC are going to be looking to rinse and repeat. Now my question is to C player, do you fancy a force up here, or are you looking for the longer game? Because both options to me are equally viable. You could go for a force buy and try and break the economy and catch LDLC off guard. That's definitely possible. Or, alternatively, if you do want to try Zanzia with the AWP, then you could save a round up. But here you go. It is a force buy. And it kind of goes by with what I'm saying before, that AWP on T side of Inferno is not that important. There are certain AWPers that can make it work, but it's very, very dependent on the CTs peaking mid. If the CTs do not peak mid, one of your main areas of getting an AWP frag is gone. And you could say the same for Dust 2, but the difference with Dust 2 is there's huge, gaping, vast landscape there to get picks with an AWP after that initial push through double doors or through suicide. Because if on A, you've got long, you've got the crossover to catwalk, you've got CT spawn. On B, you can have a peek across, you can keep an AWP at the back of B, which you see a lot of players do. Some even run with an auto sniper. On Inferno, it's a case of if you miss that first shot from a T perspective with the AWP, you're pretty much looking at banana. And if the CTs play really, really passive, your opportunities are by and large gone. So again, I think it's one of the reasons why Zanzia hasn't had as much impact on this map as he did on Cobblestone. Because Cobblestone's pretty much tailor-made for players like him, whereas this, not so much. We'll be live in 2 minutes, guys, so I'm going to keep filling it, no point us going to breaks. If you have any questions or just any general feelings, put them in chat, I'll read all of them. If you're having issues with the stream freezing or having any graphical glitches, just give it a refresh, guys, that should fix it for you. And also, hit that follow button, because we're going to have another 2 days worth of action here in the CS Arena Showdown Invitational. And all the schedule are below the streams. You can see it all there, all the times, all the dates, all that good stuff. Who won first map? First map was won by Cplay. It was on Cobblestone, and they won 16-6. Thanks, Lucas Baby. I don't know if I'm saying that right. Thanks, dude. I appreciate it. So a lot of people were saying that Cplay were going to win this sort of 16-13, 16-14. Do you still feel that way, guys? After how these last couple rounds have gone, it's 3 rounds in a row now to LDLC. 2 of them were defuses, so it suggests that the T's have got onto those sites, but we are live now in the 19th round as the force buy-in from Cplay. This is a risk, high risk, high reward kind of deal here for Cplay, and they're going to be trying to make the most of it. It's a 1-for-1 trade, Muff, and Zanzi. Well, Matt Hend, I should say. Zanzia was the receiving end of the battering from Matt Hend. But it goes pretty much in T's favour. I mean, trade-offs typically go in the T's favour. It splits the CTs up more, and of course it costs more to rebuy from a CT perspective than it does from a terrorist perspective. So, the early indications are good for Cplay. But the position here from Fox in particular is a very interesting one. He's the only player on A, so they've given up mid completely here. The terrace, of course, is much easier from my perspective because I can see the bird's eye view of the map. But this is risky. This is ballsy play from the CTs. They're putting a lot of eggs in this B basket. 2 players out of 3 are on there, and Muff's doing a great job of keeping them interested. And now, suddenly, they realize, oh crap, it's an A push. As Fox, the apps player, has been dropped and the bomb's been planted. So Devil has to make the long trek across from B to A and try and defuse that bomb. Holst gets the frag onto Devil as he pushes up mid. I thought he may try and save that, but they do have quite a lot of economy in their back pocket. Well, I say that actually, that's completely... I will stand corrected. For some reason I thought someone had 7k. No, they don't. So, I don't understand that push anymore from Devil. Why is he not saving his weapon? A 1v3 Bombs planted. Just save the assault rifle, buddy. Why are you throwing that away? So, eco for LDLC. They would have really liked that assault rifle right about now. Zanzia, please. It'll hurt my brain if no one checks this spot. Body is in such a good position to strike. The only problem is he's got a USP, but he does open up, but he doesn't get the shots off. Oh, and that's why players very often upgrade their pistol, because if that's a P250 or a 5.7 in identical position, that is at least one player dead, potentially two, maybe even three on a good day that the CTs pick themselves up. Instead, USP dinks, and that's all she wrote. Two players down from CTs, make that three. Bomb's going to get planted on A, and that is going to be the 10-10 scoreline. Question now, though, from LDLC is, do you want to save the 5.7 and P250, or do you want to try and get some exits? Not a huge amount of money to save. 500 for a 5.7, 300 for a P250. Who's this castaway from? My name's Metis, and I'm from England, northeast of England, near Newcastle. So they're kind of doing a bit of neither. They're half going for exit frags, half trying to save. What a shot from Toynew! Onto Berry, who just got slapped down with authority. Wow, he was not expecting that. C player, of course, can easily replenish that AK-47. It's an AWP on the side of Toynew. And let's see, is that going to indicate he's got a good spawn to peek mid? Absolutely is. Normally, AWP is kind of situational on CT side, and that was such a good spawn that I can understand why his eyes would light up and he'd go for it, but you can see that the T's are just not interested. They have no interest whatsoever. There's Body with a quick fire double. He gets shut down from Perry. And I thought the T's may think about just rushing in onto B side, considering they just got two frags there, but instead, they hold fast. They're going to be going afterwards. Percy's taking point for his team. He's going to feel things out. There's so many spots that you have to check because they're going to be cheeky, sneaky, beaky CTs hiding in corners that you'd never expect. Unbeknownst to them, though, the only CT player that's even close is Ruins, and that's with an AWP. But they have to check every corner. This is 101 of Inferno T-side. When you get that bomb, you check every corner. Toynew going in for the peek. If Spotted Devil out, he eats himself a grenade, but it's going to be the Molotov that seals his fate and vanquishes him to the 22nd round. Fox and Toynew both in close enough proximity to make a real go of this one, but they have no more utility. It's all been thrown out now after that flashbang, and Fox should get picked off on the cross from Muff. Finally connects enough dots to put him down, even though the AWP rings out. And it's going to be quickly traded off, and they pick up the AWP for Zanzir. And now LDLC, after going all in on that round, find themselves at potentially Deagles at Dawn, and some BT-50s as well. Zanzir peeking up mid. It's going to be two players playing aggressively down Banana, firing out a few deagles. No one's been tanked or fragged just yet. That grenade could do significant damage. No, it bounces off the wall. That Molotov is going to smart on Body. He's down to 13 hit points. Berry tagged him up through that wall significantly as well. And C-Play, after hearing the deagle and the P250, they're going to know the exact situation they're up against. They're going to know it's a pistol upgrade scenario. And that the likelihood is that there's no utility on the side of LDLC, which makes the terrorists' job that much easier. It allows them to peek a lot more, to try and get themselves a couple of frags here and there. You don't have to respect the potential of a pop flash into an all-out push, or Molotovs or grenades or any of that business. You can pretty much have free reign to do whatever you want as T's. It really does free you up. And you can see that reflected in how quickly they're pushing through mid and apps. However, Fox nearly catches himself Muff off guard. But it's Toy that breaks the deadlock. He gets dropped instantly afterwards. Again, these trades are going to fare well for the terrorists, although it is a upgraded pistol round. Here's Devil from behind with the Deagle. Gets one, looking for a second. He did land a shot or two onto Berry. But still, the CTs do fall down and only take two terrorists with them. There is enough economy for them to pick up an AWP, but again, they're not going to bother with it because it's AK heaven on CT side. On T side, sorry, of Inferno. This is a pretty big round, guys. I don't want to put too much emphasis on this because it's round loss bonus is starting to become a thing as well, a factor. That's interesting spray there, Barry, not going to lie. But this is pretty big because LDLC, again, forced themselves into this one. And from here on out, if they don't win a round, they're going to constantly be forced onto things like FAMASes and few grenades. And grenades are so important on Inferno. They really are huge from a CT perspective alongside a T perspective as well. All the pressure is on LDLC to perform now. And again, with the early trade, which has been a consistent factor on this half, the CTs have to split up that much more. And there's a good 5 to 10 seconds of rotating between A and B. So Matt Hend really has his work cut out for him. He's going to have to hold fast here and pull off some big plays. There's Devil. Beautiful spray down from Quad. Gets two players. That could be the determining point of this round. And indeed this map, 30 seconds left on the timer, Devil on Quad, gets caught out of position, and surely not again from Cplay. Zanzir is being flanked from behind from that man, Matt Hen, but it's actually Fox who gets the kill in the end, and brings LDLC that all-important round win. But momentum, that keyword once again, LDLC have to keep it going. They simply have to keep this going forward. They can't afford to slip up, make any mistakes. It's an MP9 on Devil. An MP9. Has he miscalculated this as being an eco round? Or is he just going to be taking the MP9 into a close-knit position? It looks like it's the latter. He's going onto Quad, but that's a very interesting buy for me. Normally, what people will do is go for the 5.7. It has the armor penetration. You can dink people and do serious damage, and it's a lot more reliable than an MP9 in full buy scenarios. So it's, I don't know, man, that's an odd decision, but let's see if it pays off for him. .57, of course, on top of that is a lot cheaper than the MP9 as well. Let's see what happens. That's a lovely pop flash, but it is going to go in the CT's favor. Cable coming out supreme. Toy New gets one, but he's dinked, I think, off the Berry, which put him only a couple bullets away from death. And now the MP9 with the M4 and the AK-47, it's a mixed buy here, are going to be pushing onto A, but the bomb's gone down from Zanzir, and the CT's not too interested, waiting for the cavalry to arrive. And this is the smart play. There's always strength in numbers. Especially considering that he just got that first pick in this confrontation. So it's all on Zanzir. 1v3, going for the defuse, trying to draw out the last terrorist, who is still in guard. And there's the first one, looking for the second, but just ran out of hit points. There is a defuse kit on Devil, so that is going to be 12-12. So they did the important thing. They won the round, they broke the streak, and they kept it going forward, which now pushes Cplay into the awkward position of, do we buy, do we eco? They're going to buy, they're going to have a Tech 9 on the board with a couple of Glills, but they do have grenades, and they've got plenty of grenades at that. Only the one Molotov, which could come back to be a problem, because Molotov is super huge on Inferno. There's definitely a heat joke to be made there, but I'm just going to be the bigger man and just ignore it. Rocket Pop, that skin, dude, that skin is disgusting to me, but people seem to love it, so what can you do? Rocket Pop pushing in. Devil again on Quad. He's always around this situation, but the issue is that it's such a difficult place to draw out and flush out. This is the first time we've really seen this from Cplay, and that's the Archer's push. And what a time to burst this out as well. They've consistently been one-dimensional into A or on B. This is the first time we've seen this execution of the strat, and it's worked out for them. But here's Devil. He's in a good position to get one kill. The problem is that you close yourself off. Here comes the CTs, though. They answer back in kind, and Berry in a one-on-two is going to get the bomb planted, so that's money in the bank going forward, regardless of what happens here. And he throws his grenade there kind of needlessly. I can understand it though, because he can't be affording to throw a grenade out later on. He comes down. Oh, they lined up for a split second there. They lined up for a millisecond. He was flashed. Very unfortunate for Berry. On another day, that could have even been a double, and it could have been a sick clutch. But instead, LDLC retake the lead. If you're having issues with sound, guys, try refreshing the stream. It should fix the issues for you. If not, then please let us know. So again, Cplay, after that very close round, because of the bomb plant, are able to afford another force buy with a few AKs, a Galil, a Tech 9. And now, that's three rounds in a row to LDLC. They were 12-10 behind, and I was saying, look, all the pressure is on them now to perform, and all the credit to them in the world. They've done just that. Percy with a timing push, saw that grenade coming up. That's such good play. I can't stress enough how good that is. He sees the grenade being thrown in the air. He knows the animation for the weapon switch. Doesn't allow the pit player to punish him, and he just forces through and gets the entry frag. That is next level Counter-Strike. Maybe he didn't even realize, and I'm just upping and hyping something that wasn't even there. But if he meant to do that, dude, that was amazing. It's these small little things that are just so important. Because typically, the player in pit, I didn't quite catch who it was. I think it was probably Fox, because Devil's normally around quad. Throws the smoke or the flashbang in the air. And in doing so, there's no chance he can also shoot into apps at the same time. So, straight through for Cplay, back to 13-13. And for those of you calling 16-14, 16-13 ends, it seems that you're correct. I personally think this could go overtime. I really do think it's going to go overtime. Nervous, my heart's going to blow up. Dude. You'll be okay. Seriously though, if I bet a lot on this game, I'd be bricking myself as well. Because this is close. This is intense Counter-Strike, which is what we love. So, both teams with a healthy variety of weapons and grenades. But it's going to come down to the execution. It's going to come down to the trade-offs once again, as it has so many times already in this best of three. From a neutral's perspective, I want to see a third map. But let's see. Let's see if we're going to get that. Zanzir. Boosted up on quad. Should have done better. He'll be very disappointed. And the even worse news there from the terrorists is they were unable to trade off the kill. Typically, you're okay with that trade as long as a terrorist answers the fall of their comrade. But that's not the case here. And you could see there's a player in apps that desperately wanted to peek out. I think it was Muff. Yeah, it was Muff. He wanted to press out and get the entry. But instead, it's Cplay who are bouncing back with kills of their own. They've seen Percy on quad. And there's Toynew with a kill as well. And a second. And it looked as though it could be slipping out the fingers of LDLC. They bounce back with a vengeance, and it's Berry in a 1-on-3. And he's about to be flanked in library from Matt Hend. Surely Berry's not long for this world. Throws the Molotov onto the site. He's looking for a kill. He gets the kill. But in doing so, he also gives his life up. 14-13 for LDLC. But it will be another buyout round for Cplay. They can afford this, no problems. Yes, to those of you that are just joining and asking, next map would be Cash. If LDLC can win Inferno. First map was Cobblestone. It went 16-6 to Cplay. Great resolve, great resilience from both teams being shown here. There's a lot of respect, I think, at least from myself towards these teams. I'm not sure if you guys would agree, because you're probably biased after betting skins, but the fact that both these teams have just bounced back, just refusing to stay down for the count, is always great to see from a neutral's perspective. Toynew, the only casualty early on in this round, and that's a pretty significant one because they know he's typically an A player, and that will force Body to rotate from Banana all the way through Speedway. It's another A attack. Holst really drops the ball there. Should have done better. Didn't even tag Body up that much, and you can see what that means. If the kill goes down there, LDLC's pit will crumble. Instead, it's standing tall. And that one kill, I don't want to put too much emphasis on it, but that one missed kill could prove to lose the round for Cplay. And it will do just that, 15-13 now. And Cplay have to win the next two rounds to take us into overtime. And it's going to be a Tech9 force buy. From bad to worse for Cplay. The Danes are trying to hold on for dear life. Galil for Muff. Three Tech9s and a P250 to save them from that third map. Let's see how Cplay attack the 29th round. It appears to be a B, but the bomb is lagging behind in mid. Body is there. Flash is over. Muff is going to have the first peek with the Glil, but he's unable to really get too much off that. Here comes some grenades. That's going to connect. Only does two damage the second one. Matt Hen dropped from the cables or coils. Otherwise, that would have probably been him down to around 10 HP. And he then pushes through, gets tagged down to 31. This guy refuses to go down this round. And this is a lot of energy and a lot of utility expended to push onto the site. They do get the opening pick onto Matt Hen. And surely not. Surely we're not going to see another twist in this game. There's Body with two kills. Another one as well from Devil. The bomb wasn't planted, which just adds to the woes of the Danes. If that bomb gets planted, they've got a much better chance of holding onto this site. The issue is it's been dropped in the middle of nowhere. And now Berry is by himself. Tech9 in hand. And he gets headshotted from Body. 16-13 from LDLC. And we will have a third map of cash coming up. I'm going to take a quick break, guys, because my voice is killing me at this point. I need to get myself hydrated. We'll be back in just 5 minutes for map number 3. Thank you so much for tuning in, and we'll see you very, very shortly.
Watch time unfold, and I try to make it back in this raging sea, 'cause I'm way too deep, 'cause I'm way too deep.